Hello, my name is Morgan Gray, and welcome back to the Afrocentric Podcast.
No, I've been faithful to being unfaithful. Yeah. Dumbass bitch been fool since April. I'm on this bitch neck more than bitty bitch. On GODDD, I've been BDD. Faithful baby daddy couldn't fuck with me off EDD. Addicted to dick, she got ADD. I ain't never ever picked a bitch that ain't picked me. Control your baby hairs, I'm slicker than edge control. My bitch getting hot, wait for me to the bed get cold. I just wanna see how much dick her head can hold. This feels like Blueface from 2018. If this bitch gon' keep paying, I'm selling a dream. Dead homie. All I got is dick, it don't come with a ring. Dead homie. It might sound mean if you don't know what it means. Dead homie. Cause I support the lean when it's nowhere to lean. Dead homie. You know I hit your bitch, you keep dropping the weed. Dead homie. This 4-5 dirty, but I keep it clean. Dead homie. Tell the bitch get respectful, I'm so disrespectful.
We don't funk with racism. We don't funk with people who don't support the LGBTQ plus community. And baby, we damn sure don't funk with anybody who don't love a beautiful black queen, baby. You see this case?
When they go low, I go low. Oh.
You don't let nobody act black and then go home and be white.
I got two pistols and a pit bull. Me. That's all I need.
It only takes a little bit of white brainwash to activate the coon chip in the average Negro.
You think Harriet Tubman was walking around with a fucking nice shiny fucking dress on with a fucking crown on her head when she was taking slaves to freedom?
And a lot of white folk have demonstrated eloquently that they don't have no sense.
So that's the healer. Excuse me, homewrecker. Who's the healer? The healer is normally an older sister, but she could be as young as 20. These are women who've dated, got disappointed. Dated, got disappointed. Dated, got disappointed. Dated, got disappointed. She's so tired of getting disappointed that she says, I'ma find any man and turn him into Barack Obama. This is the woman who will get Mr. Charlie the drunk off the street, get him a haircut, put him in a three-piece suit, some brand new gaiters, help him get his business up off the ground. And once she get Mr. Charlie back on his feet, he walk right out of her life with the shoes she gave him. Black women, stop trying to remake men. You can't fix nobody. Whenever you meet somebody, whether you man or woman, the first question you should ask yourself, if this is somebody you're thinking about being with, can I be with this person as they are for the rest of my life if they never changed? You know what y'all do? Y'all see one big problem, but you will ignore it. And then you brainwash yourself into thinking that once we get married, the problem gonna go away. I got news for you. Romantic problems don't get smaller after you get married. They get bigger. So if you don't like the problem now, deal with it now. It's not going away later. And let me also say to you, I know the religious people ain't going to agree with me, but you should always live with somebody for at least 3 months before you get married. Don't marry nobody you ain't live with for 90 days. We don't live in the time of Abraham and Jacob. We living with crazy blacks, and you need to know who you living with, because I could date you for 3 years and be the perfect gentleman. I pick you up, we go out to eat, go to the movies, bake some cookies, drop you off. You do that for 2-3 years, you don't know me. And you won't know me until you live in the house. You didn't know I had a second cell phone. You didn't know my baby mom called me 1 a.m. You didn't know I don't put the toilet seat after I go to the bathroom. That's right. You didn't know I fart all night in the bed. You didn't know that. And guess what, fellas? You didn't know she only took a shower once a month. She's a water conservationist. One shout. You didn't know she didn't wash her hands before she cooked. She go right out the bathroom and go make them greens. You didn't know her mother was going to be over your house every day after work. You didn't know she looked like a ghost without that wig on. So you better, I would never marry a woman I didn't live under the same roof. Now, ladies, I do have a limit. What is Dr. Umar's limit for cohabitation without putting a ring on it? 2 years maximum. If there's any woman in here who's been living with a man consecutive, not on and off, consecutive for 2 years, and he's still telling you he's not sure, he's already made up his mind, and you're not the one. Pack up and get the hell up out of there. Because if you don't, 1 minute you're 30, then you'll be 35, then you'll be, and before you know it, now you're like, I'm too old. I might as well stay. You should have left when you saw the reading on the wall. Next up, we did the healer, we did the homewrecker. Hopeless romantic, Lord have mercy. She fall in love with everybody she meet. If you a hopeless romantic, raise your hand. This is therapy. All sisters who fall in love on the first date, raise your hand. It's okay. There go one. We got one hopeless romantic, two hopeless romantics. Any more hopeless romantics? I'm going to come back and do hopeless romantic therapy. It's okay, sisters. Any more hopeless romantic? Brothers, if a woman fall in love with you after the first date, she's not mentally stable. Because guess what? So who are the
cultural leaders of dating and love during this generation within the Black community?
I think the people that should be.
Let's start.
I'm going to let you give me some, enlighten me, please.
Well, okay. Let me give some background to my listeners, because me and Chris have been going back and forth on this question for like the last 2 days. Now, I'm going to tell the people in the back, who the leaders. The leaders right now for men would be Kevin Samuels.
Where would you rank yourself on a scale from 1 to 10? How tall are you?
I'm 5'10".
5'10". How much do you weigh?
I weigh about...
To what?
Depending on the day, between 280 and 285.
So you're a fat fucker.
Yeah.
So you think a 5'10", almost 300 pound dude, how much money you make?
Like 400 every 2 weeks.
So you make 400 every 2 weeks. So you make 800 a month. You make less than $10,000 a year. Okay.
Them niggas from off the Fresh and Fit podcast.
I don't think a woman's value goes down because of her body.
Let me ask you a question. How many bodies you got then?
I'm not answering that.
Ooh. Oh! Why do you not want to answer? Because you know deep down your value is intimately tied to how many sexual partners you had when it comes to finding a man.
No, if I could ensure that my parents wouldn't see this, then I would say my body count.
Oh, so why do your parents care then?
They're definitely very culturally traditional.
Why has it been a tradition for women that are promiscuous to not be respected?
That's the patriarchy.
Who is that? The mixed race nigga that is in jail with his brother right now? You don't know who I'm talking. Andrew Tate.
I don't think there's anything intrinsically wrong with women doing OnlyFans. Mm-hmm. As long as I had influence and control over it.
What do you mean? Doing a bit of photographer and get the angles, yeah?
No. I'm not doing any real work, but just like taking all the money. If my chick said, I want to do OnlyFans, I'm like, all right, then cool, go do it. How much you made? 10 grand? All right, give me 8. All right, cool.
What woman is going to give you 8 grand?
Because you're my woman, you're doing OnlyFans. You're selling my product. What the fuck?
Your product?
Yes, correct. Next question.
No. Product? Like, do you own me? No, sorry. Like, your ego is a bit too big. You don't own me. I'm not a product. I'm not an object. Okay, Mr. Tate?
I'm just answering it.
I don't know if you're being serious.
I'm totally serious. How would I let my chick do OnlyFans and keep all the money? That's disrespectful.
What woman is ever going to give you that?
Then she better not do OnlyFans. Duh.
That motherfucker. Yes, that would be for men. Now, for women, you got Priscilla the Queen Maker.
You know what the problem is?
Yes,
they will never transition to that because there has never been an actual definition of man.
Ooh.
A lot of these guys are just male, and they're not even boys. Because boys can be trained. They can be taught. You can develop them, but male is just biological. Animals can be male, and there is a cutoff from male to man, because manhood is about transitioning through the mind. It is a mental development that a male goes through. But most of these guys get trapped in their lower nature and they never are able to get out of it. So like Jordan Peterson says, a lot of them are disagreeable. Like 85% of them are disagreeable.
Yes.
So you can't even get through to them. So because you can't get through to them and they think maleness is manhood, they have associated degenerate traits to man. Therefore, they will never transition out of it because they've never been shown or taught what a man is. They don't even know what it looks like.
Yeah, I think through a lot of tribes, there used to be ceremonies where mm-hmm. you had to transition, you had to evolve. Mm-hmm. As a man. You ever watched that movie, Apocalypto?
No, I haven't.
There's a movie by Mel Gibson, Apocalypto, I think it was 2000, but it was written in, it was spoken in Mayan, and it's about this Mayan
yes,
family.
Crazy movie.
Yeah, right. So they. So anyway, the first part of the movie is another tribe is attacking them in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
And anyway, fast forward. So he's the only one surviving from his tribe. But he goes like, listen, I'm the last one of my tribe. My father hunted in this jungle. My grandfather hunted in the jungle. And my sons will hunt in this jungle because they all went through this mm-hmm. process of evolving
right.
as men because their father and their grandfathers mm-hmm. were there to show them how to be men. Today, because of what's going on in society today, the vice family, I'm a part of it. I went through divorce. Why? Because I didn't know how to be a man.
Mm-hmm.
I was a Marine. I was a service member, but I wasn't a man.
Correct.
I was a soldier. I was a warrior, but right. I wasn't a man until somebody showed me.
And I'm glad that you said yeah. that, because what I try to teach people when I speak about male development is that males follow commands. They don't actually listen. So in the military or programs like that, they break them down and they program them to follow
it's
commands,
camp.
Right?
Yeah.
So they never actually go into themselves to really work on themselves to be leaders within themselves. So until you can get through to that guy where he makes the personal decision to discipline himself to become a man by integrating the other half of himself to fully develop, he never will. He never will, because it takes so much energy and effort, because as men, you all have to battle the effects of testosterone. You have to live up to society's unrealistic expectations of you as male. There are biological impediments that most people do not know that males have. So it becomes a big mountain of work that males have to do that they just give up on. And as long as you reward them for minimal effort, they never will transcend. And since sex is the most important thing to a male, if you give it to him too easy, he's done.
There you go. They'll earn it.
You have Shira 7.
Before I met James, my husband, every time a man would approach me, I would risk it all. And I would, like, if he wanted to date me and things like that, if he wanted to go out with me, I would risk it all and say, okay, I'll go on a date with you, da da da. And then during the day, he's like, a lot of guys want you to be their girlfriend right away, especially if you're young and pretty and they're old and ugly, or fat and ugly, or young and fat, or young and ugly, and or whatever. They want to scoop you quick because you look good, right? And you're a rare find. And most women like you don't give them the time of day, right? So once they ask you, oh, you want to be my girlfriend, like after the second date, because they do. Well, I don't date guys unless they do A, B, C, and D, pay my bills, spoil me, and da-da-da. Put it all on the table. They will either say yes or no. Then in disbelief, well, okay, well, thank you. I had a good time on this date. I wish you the best of luck. Then they'll pull the line. Well, you're going to be alone. You're not going to ever find anyone like that. Not true. Keep your standards high. Tell men what you want. Somebody's going to give it to you. Now, you can't go around acting like that and asking for those things if you're not attractive or leveled up. You can't, because they're gonna laugh at you. Or you gotta pick your target correctly.
You got the spiritual whistleblower.
Listen, it's a couple of celebs I've always been curious about. I know you already said Kevin Samuels. We're not going to disrespect him or mention his size of his head or whatever. But Jada Pinkett.
Jada, in my opinion, is a full-blown narcissist.
Ooh,
she's full-blown.
No, you didn't.
Yes.
She got a small head, too. I wonder if the correlation with smaller head.
And Will, too. They both are.
So how does that work? Two narcissists together. They should be happy. They should stick together.
They're not happy, but that's the glue to their marriage. She's toxic as fuck. She disrespects him, emasculates him. But he's doing his shit. He's the breadwinner. He's doing everything, too. I've been called Jada out like 2 years ago. I hate the red table talk. Jada knows she's a narcissist. She's full blown.
See, that went over my head. I just figured that like she got good coochie or something. I'm a huge rap fan, like the rappers or musicians. Who's huge to you? Like a huge narcissist. Like
Future, Drake, all of them. Baby, Lil Baby, Da Baby, all of them. The ones with multiple baby mamas. They control women with money, but women are nothing more than objects. So they trap them with the baby and they jump into a new relationship.
It's all types of men and women out here that are giving unsolicited but very thorough dating advice to the community. Mm-hmm. Now, the second half of the question is what types of reactions or information are they giving out to the community and what effect are they having? So, like, let's go down the side of the men.
Okay.
So, we got Kevin Samuels, who is dead and gone.
How you feel about him for real?
Okay. As a historian, I wanted to watch his shit unbiasedly and develop my own thoughts on Kevin Samuels. Kevin, he started off differently from the way that he ended up ending, right?
Okay.
I feel like Kevin created a safe place for a lot of black men to be able to sit down.
A lot.
And he also gave a lot of good advice to help me understand why women weren't fucking with him.
Right.
Now, there's the difference between him, Andrew Tate, or the Fresh and Fit podcast niggas. Like, them men will just tell men, go work out and fuck these bitches and be an alpha man. Kevin Samuels was telling these niggas to lose weight. He was telling them what to wear.
So your thing too little, son.
And yes, he was getting their mental together.
Right. That's what I'm here for.
Okay. Man. But you also have to be very honest about a lot of the shit he was saying. It was fatphobic. It was transphobic. It was very sexist. Kevin Samuels, later within his career, before his untimely death, he was mean as fuck. He wasn't just mean to women.
He didn't get to you wrong.
It was still harmful to the psyche of the black man.
We don't care. We gotta hear it.
You can hear it, but there's a better way to deliver shit, because he was still calling these niggas big, sloppy, lazy, fucking fridge protectors. He was calling these niggas everything.
It's true.
But it's enough people beating up on black men. Mm-hmm. They should. I feel like as a black man, you should want to hear something to uplift you. If you're going to hear the honest and raw truth, mm-hmm. it should be delivered in a way that makes you feel comfortable.
That may be the way to motivate them. Okay, you talk about me so bad. Okay, I'm finna go to the gym now. You keep telling me to, can you just go work out? Can you go do this? I ain't trying to hit. It's weeks late. I still ain't did.
But
you call me out my name, get what? I gotta go do something now.
See, but that's the thing that's scary. Now, and I'm tied to sex. Mm-hmm. So, like, right now with our generation, when people are having sex, they are so turned on to violence. So, you thinking about bitches, they like to get choked during sex. They want to get slapped during sex. They want to go to the hospital.
On top of me.
Why is it that the violence perpetrated upon your body is what makes you happy, what makes you come and makes you want to go? And in the same breath, you can think about that type of information. Why is it that negativity, hatred, and you being shit up on motivating you to want to do better for yourself? That should reveal something about what motivates you and gets you to go.
Where do you think they come from, though?
That comes from slavery. That comes from post-traumatic slavery. And you have to be educated enough to be able to see that and recognize it and want better for yourself. I don't want to go to the hospital while I'm fucking on no nigga.
Uh-oh.
I'm trying to go see God.
Uh-oh.
I'm not trying to go see Dr. Shabam.
Come on now. You're going to be up in there.
Oh, well. All I'm saying is like, it could have, for black men, I want better.
Mm-hmm.
They deserve better. They don't deserve to be shat up on when they trying to receive help. Therapists ain't going to talk to y'all like that. At the very least, you go to a therapist, at least they'll give you a fucking compliment, tell you you did something right.
But that woman ain't, so they go back to the woman. It's a man and woman battle all the time.
It don't have to be, though.
Right. Then we need to go and get together.
I remember this dude on live one time. He was like, I was on his live, and he was like, my love language is physical touch and quality time. And I was like, oh, every dude says their love language is physical touch and quality time, because like dudes, we always want to get physical. And he was like, nah, he's like, for me, my love language is like physical touch, because growing up, like, I grew up in a household where like my, I think he grew up in like a military household, and he was like, my parents were very like, you're a boy, you're fine, tough it out. He's like, if I fell down like 3, 4, 5 years old, like if I fall down, it's like, get up, you're good, don't cry, like you'll be all right. Like, it was just always like this toughness. He's like, I just never experienced like getting like affectionate physical care, right? Like, he never experienced like physical intimacy that was like rooted in like love, nurture, right? Like, it was always just kind of like, come on, come on, you got this, get up, like you're better than this, you're bigger than this. And he's like, so now in dating, like if I'm having a bad day, my girlfriend like hugs me, it feels so good, because I feel like extremely affirmed, like I feel comforted, like I feel like I'm allowed to like just exist in this place, like somebody's telling me like they care about me. And it just really got me thinking, because what I said initially, I'm not gonna say it's ignorant, because I think it does stand true for like a lot of different types of people. However, like, got me thinking how like as a woman and dating and like dating men, like I will say one thing but then like maneuver in a different way. So for instance, it's like I will say like, you know, I want somebody who is soft, who is understanding, who is, you know, emotionally mature and can communicate like an adult, and somebody who is like recognizes patriarchy, misogyny, and does everything in their power to go against it, and all of these things, right? But then like sometimes my dating practices literally is copy paste of misogyny as patriarchy, because I am someone who is socialized in misogyny and patriarchy. Like, and it got me thinking, that's like how a lot of women are. Like, a lot of us were like socialized in this, and like sometimes it's easy to just kind of always be like, like, here's how the men need to change, the men need to have a different framework, the men need to show up better. But it's also like, how are we like unpacking like the misogynist in our own head? How are we like unpacking like frameworks of patriarchy in our own head, things that we carry around that we're like, oh well, this is just what I like, oh well, this is just innate. And I remember back in like 2020 2021, I went on this date. It was one of my first times experiencing. I went on a date and it was vibes, but he never tried to kiss me by the end of the night. And so like when I got home and he got home, he was like checking in on me, like, did you get home safely, everything. I was like, yeah. I was like, it was cool. And like the conversation eventually came up, and I was like, you know, I just think it was weird, like you didn't try to kiss me. He's like, did you want me to kiss you? And I was like, yeah. And he's like, well, I definitely wanted to kiss you, but like I wasn't gonna kiss you without your permission. Like, and he's like, and I didn't know that was the vibes you were on. And this was a moment where I was realizing like, oh, this is the radical consent I talk about. This is the radical consent that I spend, because like I did like repro advocacy. This is the radical consent that I spend my work telling young people, like, oh, radical consent. Like you should be radically asking, like, do you like this? Do you want this? Can I do this? Can I have this? And the other person should be radically consenting and saying, yes, do this. Yes, don't do this. But like here I was in a moment where I'm like, well, I'm used to dudes just making the move. I'm used to a guy just like, just trying to kiss me. Like I'm used to a guy just like, you know, and then if I don't want that, like I'll stop you. But then I'm sitting here thinking like, but that's not how it should work, right? Like as adults, like we should both be having this radical conversation of like, oh yeah, this has been a really fun night. Like I would love to kiss you. Like, would you like to kiss me? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, and I get like some people are like, oh, it takes away the romance. But the only reason we think it takes away the romance is because why, we were socialized in a world that taught us that someone just bombarding you with physical intimacy, someone just bombarding you with a kiss, someone just grabbing your body without your consent, not saying anything, just doing it because the vibes are right, is romantic. And someone consensually asking like, can I do this? Do you feel comfortable with this? What if I did this? Is not romantic. It's like, why are you asking all these questions? Why are you da 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 da? But then if the person that we don't want, the person that we don't like, if the move that we didn't expect happens, we're like, whoa, what are you doing? And then this person's over there like, well, I thought this was the right time. Like, I thought I had the right vibe. And so I think about this. I think about this a lot in, like, my dating practices. Like, what are things that I still, like, need to unpack within myself that continues to perpetuate, like, misogyny and patriarchy and harm that's caused to me and caused to other women, right? Like, and if I'm dating someone and I watched a video this morning where this guy was talking about, like, the flowers thing, because I guess this girl was dating this dude and the dude was like, oh, can you give me flowers? And the girl was like, oh, that's an ick, you're a sassy man or whatever. And this guy was talking about like some of the things that people say is sassy is just like coded homophobia. I have a friend who is a big believer in giving men flowers. Like, she buys her brothers, her cousins, she buys them all flowers because she's like, she buys everybody flowers. She buys me flowers. But she also is like, oh yeah, and I also get men flowers. And her thing is, she's like, because a lot of times people don't get flowers until they're dead. And also, like, I want to, because her brother's younger. She's like, I want to raise him understanding nurture. And it was like, the, like, when she said that, I like really thought about it, where I'm like, nurture is such a thing that, like, womanhood, I've been privileged to understand nurture, because I feel like womanhood, like, exists within nurture. Like, we grew up on so much nurture. If you grew up with aunties, with like maternal figures in your life, like, if you grew up in, I always say I grew up in a matriarchy, I grew up around a lot of strong, amazing women. Like, if you grew up around, like, bomb, like, maternal people, figures, like, you understand nurture. Like, nurture's really a thing. It's like, it's like they gonna rock for you, they gonna make sure you're taken care of, they're gonna comfort you, they're gonna check you when you're wrong. And that's also nurture. Like, nurture's a real thing. But, like, I don't think all the time, like, manhood, boyhood has nurture embedded into it. Like, men are the bare minimum are taught to be providers, are loosely taught to be protectors, because a protector is very, like, situational and based on, like, your type and this, da 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 da. But, like, women literally are just taught to be, like, that mad nurturing. Like, we're expected to be nurturing. That's why, like, whenever you see, like, women who deviate from, like, things within society that people are like, oh, this is something that's supposed to be nurturing, like, they're looked down on. But when she said that, when she's like, oh yeah, I make sure to like buy my brother's flowers, and like we go on dates, and like, you know, I make sure to like teach him, you know, how to be kind, how to be caring, how to think of others. I'm like, never did growing up receiving nurture from another woman make me be like, oh, and I don't need to care about anybody. Receiving that nurture made me want to care about other people, made me want to love on other people, made me want to nurture other people. When I was growing up and I'd have aunties do my hair, it made me be like, one day I want to be able to help somebody do their hair. Like, one day I want to be able to, like, be there for somebody in that way. Like, I want to be able to nurture somebody. Being fed made me be like, damn, like, I love cooking, and I want to be able to feed people the way, like, when people come to my mom's crib, they love eating, they love, like, chopping with her, they love hanging out with the fam. Like, and when she said that, pretty much, like, the reason I do this with my brother is because, like, I want him to have this in his, like, dating life, when he dates women, when he takes them out. Like, I want him to be nurturing, like, I want him to be caring. I was like, so yeah, that's my little rant. Anyways.
So now we on the flip side of this coin, and we looking at the women who are representing dating and love for black women. So right now you have Priscilla the Queen Maker. Have you heard of her?
I heard that name.
So Priscilla is, I feel like she's like a bisexual woman. So Priscilla became famous because she was on Fresh and Fit podcast. She's like a 30-year-old woman, okay, and she is super smart, and she can articulate. She probably one of the first women that got on that show, and she probably played real quiet until she got on there and got to telling them niggas. She made them Fresh and Fit niggas shut the fuck up.
Baby, it's real simple. Let's just put it to the test, yes, right? Or let's put it to the test, because see, we ain't traveling across seas trying to go find no pussy. We ain't passport girls, but that ain't us. Let's put it to the
test. Y'all get flued out.
Whoa.
Okay. Let's put passport girls.
Yeah, let's put it to the test, right?
Okay. On their own television show.
I see. You fucking with them.
I'm fucking with her. She okay. She ended up on Real Life Street Stars, and she did interviews with their podcast as well, and just sitting up there listening to her, like, I like her mindset because it is still rooted in Afrocentricity. She's the one that's calling out the passport bros, really the incel community, the black incel community, telling them that they wrong and trying to encourage black women to be able to think for themselves. Mm-hmm. So I personally like Priscilla the Queen Maker. Then about 6 months ago, we had the Goddess Shira 7 explosion. Have you heard of Shira? The Sprinkle Sprinkle Beach. Sprinkle Sprinkle.
Can I have a something something friends with benefits? Nope, that's ratchet. Sprinkle sprinkle, you know how many women are sitting there mad because they got pregnant by their friends with benefits and they done disappeared? Now they asking if they can still level up with two babies and a this and that. Yeah, you can still level up, but I don't believe in friends with benefits. Where is your benefits? Are the benefits money, baby? Are those benefits in cash? Because if they not, I don't see no benefit. Where's the cash? Okay, that's only benefits for men. Okay. If he can't pay your bills, you're not benefiting. You're just giving away free sex to some random dude with no commitment. That's all you're doing, and it's ratchet. Sprinkle, sprinkle. And I'm not being mean. I'm giving you tough love because that's what you need to hear. Somebody's not going to tell you the truth. I just did. You're just being used with no commitment, and you still got to pay your own bills. Okay?
That's her. So. I'm on TikTok.
Yes.
Gotcha.
So she is exclusively on YouTube, and Shira is in the dating industry. She is a witch. She is a self-proclaimed witch. That's why she is called Goddess Shira Seven. But her husband, his name is James, he a old man. He old as fuck. She said when they got married, everybody was calling her a gold digger. So when they came out to Gold Digger by Kanye West and danced to it. But
I'm
screaming too. But we like Shira because Shira tells the truth. And she exposes the holes within men's logic. And she also promotes self-esteem and self-love. Always choosing yourself first. And that's something that a lot of women have not gotten to yet. But I feel like her fan base is similar to with the Fresh and Fit Andrew Tate fan base, because they're also in that position where they're stereotyping and grouping black men together and these red flags and all this other shit. Mm-hmm. And then the final one is a spiritual whistleblower, and she's focused on exposing narcissism within black men and stuff. So
I want to talk to black women real quick about the power of karma. You know, if you've ever been involved with a black man and he cheated, he was verbally abusive, he broke you down, left you with a baby high and dry, you know, he did everything to break your spirit, put his hands on you. He got in the streets and talked about you like a dog. That's what we call a smear campaign. He turned his family against you. If you guys had any mutual friends, he turned them against you. He spread vicious rumors. He knew he abused you the entire relationship, yet he's out in these streets vilifying you. A lot of you feel really cheated. A lot of you are like, damn, how could he just destroy my life, leave me with a child? You know, he took all my money. You know, he dogged the fuck out of me. And then he just moved right on with a new woman, got her, you know, married her, spoiled her, did everything for her by treating me like shit. A lot of y'all feel cheated. A lot of y'all are walking around right now like, damn, I wish that man would get his karma today. I wish God would do something about him today. I'm angry. I'm bitter that he did me dirty. Let me explain something. This whole Tory Lanez incident is a prime example of what happens to the arrogant, cocky, narcissistic black man, the sociopath, psychopath that shows no signs of remorse after he does somebody dirty. A lot of y'all forget that prior to this whole incident with Megan Thee Stallion, Tory Lanez was already beating and whooping on women. Tory Lanez was already on probation parole. Tory Lanez wasn't supposed to be seen with a gun. He violated his probation. He put his hands on August Alsina. He has another baby mama. He was whooping on her. The man has a history of being violent. How many of y'all like y'all are like, you know, I just can't believe the yes, I can. Yes, I can. Because that's the problem with black people. We are walking around undiagnosed with narcissistic personality disorder. We are walking around undiagnosed as sociopaths and psychopaths co-signing other abusers. That's why motherfuckers are mad that Tory Lanez ain't getting off. It's a lot of black men walking around that and whooped and beat on a black woman and got away with it. Now they sitting back mad as fuck because they watching Tory suffer the consequences for his behavior. And he got money. Okay, he's a celebrity and he got busted. So now these black men that have been abusing black women are walking around scared as fuck now. Because Tory Lanez is the current poster boy for what happens to a fuck nigga that constantly keeps disrespecting, violating, abusing black women and think he can get away with it. No, you can't. You can't. Black women, leave these narcissistic fuck boys alone. They will get their karma. Tory did.
Well, every nigga,
that's a new word I hear.
I'm tired of hearing
What's
it.
The definition of that word?
A narcissist is, well, The word narcissist comes from the Greek word in a Greek story, narcissistes, but essentially it was a man who stared at himself in a river in Greece, and a garden nymph came up and saw that he was obsessed with himself. So she gave him like a mirror, or she enchanted the water, and for the rest of his life, he became obsessed with the look of himself until he died. So that's where the word narcissist comes from. But it's someone who centers themselves first, and they will put you in situations for the betterment of self and the downfall, regardless of the downfall of yourself, in order to gain more.
Okay, I ain't know, but I just hear it all the time. I'm like, okay, so basically selfish?
Yes, egotistical, narcissist.
Okay, it makes sense now.
But it's a medical, it's a mental thing. Like, it is.
Oh, it's serious.
It's a mental disease. People are diagnosed with narcissism. Like, it's bad.
That's crazy.
Well, social media popularizes mental health. So, like, you, great example of this is white people. So, like, because white people have privilege, what they do is when they want to become a part of the intersection, they'll grab a mental illness and assign it to themselves to make themselves seem as if they have less privilege. And social media gives us access to all these different mental illnesses, all these, what, these attributes that you might have, and then they kind of just place them on themselves and be like, I'm just like you, I'm oppressed, they're discriminating against me based off of my disabilities. Mm-hmm. So you'll see that in like day-to-day life. So now we're talking about the gender war, and the gender war, I personally feel like, was created to keep us divided. Mm-hmm. And it is working so well.
So well.
But my thing is when I see people participating in that type of rhetoric online, I always assume that they are stupid. Like, I can, I'm so serious. I could assume that they don't have education. They are not able to process an analytical thought, because no black people are a monolith. Do you understand what I'm saying when I say that?
Say it again.
Black lives are not a monolithic experience. Mm-hmm. So when I'm saying that, that means that the prefix mono means one. That means that, so monolithic means one life. Not all black people live one certain life. So you can't take all that information and put it up on one person and expect it to fit. Mm-hmm. So this shit, it'll never work that way. And it's the same way when it comes to dating. So you getting on the internet and you voicing your opinions and you saying all niggas sound ain't shit. Stupid. Sound retarded. And there are no good niggas left.
Okay, when people say, all niggas ain't shit, right? But you got a certain preference. How you gonna put everybody under a certain pressure when you like thugs? Let's say, for example, you like thugs. You want niggas in the street. So every nigga you dealt with
was thug ass nigga.
But now you put on social media, all niggas ain't shit. That's all niggas you dealt with.
Mm-hmm. And that is, again, sometimes it's a reflection of you. Sometimes it's a reflection of where you are, and sometimes it is who you attract. I don't feel like everything is a reflection of you, because sometimes it's not.
Okay.
But no, you have to be careful. And I just feel like shit like that is super, super ignorant. But back to the leaders. Now, we finished talking about Kevin Samuels. Mm-hmm. Now we can go to like the Andrew Tates and the Fresh and Fits. Now, these some white men, mm-hmm, caricature as black men. They put on the black face and they go out and they do their day-to-day living. Yeah, you know, he mixed. His dad is black and he was raised by a white woman. That's a red flag in and of itself. So, and he don't like women. And now he in jail right here. Romania in jail.
He don't like women. Like, he don't like women as in,
like, as friends or as people. He sees women as sexual objects where he can make money off of them. That's why he in Romania in jail right now.
Andrew.
Yeah, that's him. Now he's sitting up under the jail. He got cancer. His hair falling out. Well, his hair growing back, but in patches.
God don't like ugly.
No, they don't. He don't like filth either. But then you got these Fresh and Fit ass niggas. They got one African nigga and then one light skinned nigga. They ain't no niggas. They still whitewashed too. And they pussy. They are, they pussy. They sit in that room. They some hoe ass niggas.
Mm, I gotta listen to them. I wanna see what they talking about.
Nothing, because what they gonna do is they gonna put each other in the front and they gonna be surrounded in a room full of the dumbest, bimbo ass, none speaking up ass bitches, and they'll just argue with them for 3 hours at a time. He's speaking to bitches that can't even articulate or formulate a fucking thought, and they using that predatorily to make money off of them. That's and crazy. They rude. They'll just kick them bitches out, call them bitches to their face.
What?
I know. Yeah, well, if you could sit up there and just swallow that nonsense, you can, but I feel like there's so much better shit to be doing than to be sitting up here just listening to men just bash women all day and remind them how stupid they think that they are.
They must have forgot they got a mama.
They had to have.
Auntie, grandma.
Had to have. Somebody. But he was raised by a white woman. That's what I'm trying to get you to understand. Okay. They were raised by white women. So they view the world through the lens that their mother view the world through.
And they had no idea what really going on.
No, because white women don't really have no sense of partnership or community within the white community. It's very surface level. Mm-hmm. These bitches got roots and shit.
For real.
Okay.
Y'all, 2023 is such a crazy year because not only did Fresh and Fit podcast get demonetized on YouTube, but also, I got this article from Media Takeout. And yeah, I fact-checked it. It's accurate.
Man, we got a very important announcement for you guys. It won't be the same, bro. Yeah. The channel has been kicked off the YouTube partner program. Mm. Just keep it straight with
y'all. If you look right now, you can't even super chat. Or
you can't even super chat right now.
Good.
Yep. So this is the beginning of the end of this era.
We're working with YouTube to try to come to a middle ground and, you know, work together and figure this out. But for now,
we don't even know why.
Don't know the specific reason. When you guys send me your DMs and say, yo, you saved my life.
No
yo,
one sends stuff to them like that. Yo, don't have to listen to them.
My girl is making sandwiches now or whatever it is, right? We've helped a lot of you guys from yourselves, from making a really bad decision. What I'm asking you guys is, just like we've saved you guys, we need you guys to save us.
Now, I highly doubt anybody is writing them emails saying that you made my girlfriend make a sandwich. But if you actually read through the community guidelines on YouTube, they have violated those community guidelines numerous amount of times. That includes the promotion of the attacks on women. Okay, and I'm not even going to go into the details. You know exactly what it is that they talk about. Now, Media Takeout reports that the host broke the news on their podcast yesterday and warned their fans that they had planned to shut things down shortly. Now, the podcast has become a subject of controversy in the past due to comments made by Weeks and Gaines, most notably during their viral conversation with Instagram model Brittany Rayner, I think that's how you pronounce her name, earlier this year, where they made alleged misogynistic comments towards her. Now, earlier this year, which I didn't know, the podcast was demonetized for about 7 days from YouTube, and they stated that YouTube had warned them if they continued to make content like that, that they would be banned. I need men to do this, because if men are listening to this podcast, the only thing that you need to do is not listen to them, and there's a multitude of reasons as to why. The first being that these men don't actually give you relationship advice. The mass majority of men who watch their content are probably single, so the only advice that they should be giving you is dating advice, and not in the sense of how to treat the woman after you get her, but how to actually get the woman. See, Fresh and Fit podcast never actually teaches men the art of dating, the art of courting women or getting women. They only give you the aftermath of once you obtain the woman and what to do with her then. So instead of sitting around listening to people like this who have no proximity to women or probably haven't touched a woman in years, what men actually need to do is get off the internet and go out to bars and commingle with women. Men have adopted and put women on this very high pedestal, so much so that they feel like that they are unattainable, and they begin to envy women. And when you envy women, then you want to de-feminize them and make them into your perpetual slaves, which you can't do if you don't actually get women. So instead of podcasts like this, just go outside and touch some grass and go talk to a woman.
But actual narcissism is extremely rare in real life. Like, it's very rare to find someone who actually is diagnosed as a narcissist. Right. So people use it as a blanket term. Anybody who don't do what you want them to do is a narcissist.
Right.
So you have to be careful with shit like that.
Like, a lot of white people use that term.
Yes, they do.
But we don't hear that on the nigga land.
Oh, on nigga TikTok, I do. I do.
I had to get off TikTok. Now, TikTok was taking a lot of my time.
It take a lot of mine.
That woman kept popping up on my mind.
Who?
Saying, you're scrolling too much. Can you please take no shit? Okay, I had to leave the app for a minute because that's all I'm doing.
Now, we then went ahead and defined all the people who represent love and dating within our communities. Mm-hmm. Who do you think are the people that we should be looking up to?
Okay, the people we should be looking up to is, I say, for number one, is a pastor. I feel as if a pastor, you need to be in a relationship. You should be married. Got a family. You know what I'm saying? It just don't feel right coming a pastor telling you how to live by the Bible, and you ain't even first foot in the door. That's supposed to be, go back to shacking. That's in the Bible. How could you be a shacker if you know you're a pastor? Okay.
Okay. I won't agree with these, but I can't.
Okay, talk to him.
Because the Bible is written and used as a way to systemically oppress Black people. Mm-hmm. So if you take the literature and you base that based off your love life, yes, it'll give you guiding principles. It'll give you life lessons, but as a whole, it'll force you to look at life through a Eurocentric or a whitewash point of view.
Right. And I don't like that. Okay, next person, I got like police officers.
I'm not going to sit here and let you say why? That. Fuck 12.
Fuck 12, but them the people that we have a better opportunity with the people,
hey, now, with the people being married. I'm going to stop you right there because police officers have the highest domestic abuse rates out of any other profession. Because
they got the wrong ones in them.
Yes.
That's my whole point. That's the whole point.
Okay, so y'all don't listen to the police.
That's the whole point. They hiring people that they ain't even got their life together.
My God.
So of course they number one.
Maybe firefighters. I'll let them niggas listen to a firefighter. Them niggas running in the burning buildings.
You heard I said these people should be.
Okay.
If they need to revamp, they need to reclean them out, put them back on.
Uh-huh.
Teachers and principals.
Okay.
How could you be a teacher or a principal? You ain't even a relationship now. Relationship really carries throughout like your life process. Older you get, you ain't in a relationship, or you ain't married, and you in these high positions. That shows a lot about yourself too.
You can't
get a man. You can't keep a woman.
I feel like that's.
But you a principal.
It's an old mindset though.
Fathers told me that if a woman's over 32, never been married, never had any kids, there's something wrong with her.
All right, tell your daddy. That if you find a woman who is 32 years old, don't have any kids, never been married, tell your daddy that she's educated and that she's planning to make financial decisions so she can afford the children that she has and send them to college instead of having them standing at the L stop. She can drive a Lexus to work. Tell your daddy that the woman is a boss.
Everybody don't want to get married. And I think... No, because as women, all our lives, we have been forced to center love, marriage, relationships, and children as the whole focal point of our life.
Mm-hmm.
Our whole lives have been set up for us to want to get married, wait till we get married, and that's supposed to be all you are for the rest of your life.
Which is a...
It's a farce.
Ayo, whatever. How can I say that? They're really crazy. I can't speak up on it. You folks, they what they want you to do. Get married and live with that person the rest of your life.
Yeah, that's it. That's all you got to look up to. Or your responsibility is to raise men with these values and then raise girls to be able to have more children to raise men. So, like, it is a continuous cycle. No, you just have to decenter relationships. Relationships should not be your primary goal and focus in this lifetime. It can be a part of you, but it does not have to be you in your entirety.
I got you.
Give me another example then.
Who else we got?
Take your time.
Who else we got?
Let the Lord use you.
What is number three?
Number three. See, because it ain't. Look, imagine what type of relationship you want for yourself.
I want. I already got my stuff rolled out. I'm ready. I'm just waiting on $1 million. That's it.
My God.
That's it. I'm ready. And me, I'm the type of person, I adapt everywhere I go.
That's good.
Adaptation is number one, and your should be number one in your relationship, in your lifestyle. wherever you go, you work a 9 to 5, you gotta adapt. Mm-hmm. You just go with this girl, you gotta adapt. You go to your mama, you gotta adapt, go to church, you gotta adapt to what's going on around you. Not just be yourself, but you know, you gotta adapt.
That's real.
What are the 5 types of dysfunctional sisters? Hopeless romantic, homewrecker, homicidal honey, the healer, high maintenance. Look at the sisters, they shaking and which one am I? We're going to start with the homewrecker. This is the woman who has had her man taken from her so many times from other women that she has now decided to get revenge by taking other women's men. She might have 2 or 3 men and they all got wives. And she gets her self-esteem from knowing that she was able to sleep with another woman's husband. She is the home wrecker. And let me tell you women something right now about home wrecking sisters. I need to tell y'all this. This is going to hurt. If your best friend ain't got no man. Y'all been together since first grade, but she ain't got no man. And she thinks she got a chance with yours. What would you rather have, a best friend or a husband? See how that go? I have seen relationships between women destroyed because the man kind of flirted with the best friend, got her hopes up, and she slept with him. When he never planned to leave the wife, he was just playing with her, and now their friendship is over. Black men, don't do that. If you know your woman is thirsty for you, pull her to the side and say, listen, I see the way you're looking at me, but I need you to put your tongue back in your mouth. You my girl's best friend. I'm not going to tell her we had this conversation. Don't text me no more after the hours. Because women want men. That's their natural. They're supposed to have a husband. And if they think they got a chance with your man, forget your friendship of 50 years, 20 years. She going for the husband. So keep your friends away from your man. Especially if she look better than you.
Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord.
Wait. And guess what? Black woman, don't you ever, ever, ever let your best friend cook for your man too much, especially if she can cook better than you. Because what are the 2 strongest cravings of a man? Sex and hunger. And the stomach is right over the reproductive, and they are related. I'm going to tell you how it works. You come home one day. Your best friend live next door neighbor. She say, hey, Shaquita, I made a pineapple. I made me some sweet potato pie. See if Henry wants some. Sure, I'll give him some. Damn, this is some good pie. Next week, I made some beef ribs and some mac and cheese and some of that Barbadian jumper fish and hooked it up with the onions. He falling in love with it through the food and you don't even see. And then one day, he come home early. How you doing, sister? Hey, where your wife? She come in later. Guess what? I made a pineapple upside down cake. Would you like a slice? I just did it first time. Hey, would you like to get a slice? He went in that house. She gave him a slice of the pineapple upside down cake. And guess what happened? After he ate that cake, he had her upside down in the damn cake. Listen, every brother in here know what I'm saying when I say this. Every man in here, including me, we have all dated a woman who we normally would not have dated until we tasted her food. I can think of one right now. I said, oh, hell no. But once she did them shrimps and them deviled eggs and that tuna salad and that homemade ginger lemonade, I looked at her ass after dinner. I said, damn, you do look like Beyonce.
Chris, I'm really excited about this question right here. So the question reads, how would you define black love? How would your friends define black love? And how would your parents define black love?
How would I define black love? I would define black love as two individuals coming together to build a stable mindset within each other. That's number one.
Okay.
Listen to one another.
Mm-hmm.
Try to build an empire because we know what's against us nowadays as black people.
Mm-hmm.
We got to do what we got to do to be in a relationship nowadays. Okay, for my friends, they probably think like me as well, but I probably think they'll think like, get a girl that you like, spend money on them, do this, do that. And I don't even hear about marriage, so. That's the crazy part.
And that's why I wanted to ask this question, because although you can have certain perceptions, the way that your friends and family feel about it, they're going to differ. Right. They're going to differ.
Okay. For my family, my whole family married. Everybody. Yeah. Mama, daddy, my cousin. All my cousins married. I got 3 girl cousins. All of them married. Oh, and this, my mom and them said. My other cousin married. Everybody married on this side.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody. So I grew up knowing about marriage. So now I'm just working within myself to, you know, learn.
To get there, because that's what you grew up seeing.
That's all I see. Everybody married. It's so crazy. Everybody went to college as well. But they expect me to keep, I'm different.
You could.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, you cut from bandana cloth. And from the rest of these motherfuckers cut from tissue paper.
Everybody think I'm a millionaire though.
Hey. We walking in our calling.
Hello.
That's all I got to say.
I'm going to stay there until I come up.
Look now. But I feel like when we talk about marriage, I think that people focus on the fact that throughout history, people have done marriage for benefit and for profit. So, like, especially with, like, in the Middle Ages, the Old Ages, with royalty or people of high rank, they marry in order to gain wealth, in order to obtain more power.
They do it the right way.
It's not necessarily the right way. It's a strategic way.
There you go.
There's a reason and a purpose behind it. So now we've gotten to this point in society where, for the most part, we are looked at as equal. So now this is like one of the first of two generations who are truly able to marry for love, especially within the black population. Ever since niggas was niggering on America, niggas was getting married. They were always getting married, but they were getting married for love as well as to be able to obtain different things. Like, women would marry for protection. Mm-hmm. Women would marry for money, all types of different things.
Stability.
Thank you. That's what I'm looking for. And then they would create children in order to get work done, to be able to cultivate more money, to be able to get more labor done. So now we're getting to this point in life, in our generations, where we truly can say, I want to marry for love. Okay, so what does that look like as a black person?
Right. We don't know what it looks like, but we so misguided. People say we love you, but we really don't. We really using you, and it's just really, you blind. Some people are blind to the fact that they can't see, like, when somebody uses you versus loving you. Then it really, 9 out of 10, is lust.
Mm.
You look, you see something that, oh, I hit her. Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. A nigga ain't jumping your inbox for decoration.
My God.
He ain't jumping your inbox to love you.
My God.
He wanna, at first, he gotta talk to you, see, they like you first. If you respond, he think he got you.
Wow. That's powerful, Chris.
It's so simple.
It's so simple.
Like you say, men know what they want. We know what we want, but we got to, whatever we looking at, we most definitely got to make sure that's what we want at the same time. But you don't need what you want.
Oh, that is very true. Oftentimes, what you want is not what you need.
You see that dude with them glasses, he look like a nerd. They got his pants up. You don't like him. That ain't your
but
style.
He might be what you need.
But that's exactly
that
what you need.
That ugly motherfucker gonna give you money, protection. Right. His mama gonna thug you because he got a face only a mother could love.
Hello. Just that simple. But us black people, we want what we want. So that's why we're going to stay where we is.
The heart want what the heart want.
You got to stop that heart, man.
If I stop the heart, I'm going to die.
Hell, that will probably happen.
So how has social media played a role in how Gen Z students tend to engage in dating and relationships on college campuses? Like
college campuses.
Specifically, let's talk about this specific arena or this specific generation, Gen Z as a whole.
Oh, my God. It is, I say it is fun.
Is it?
Maybe. When Tinder came out.
Was you heard it? Of Tinder? Of course. Who ain't? Her Bumble, Tinder, Christian Mingle, Plenty of Fish.
But when Tinder came out, swipe right, swipe left.
That was so much fun.
That was a college year for me. I wasn't even in college, but my okay, the type of person I am now. I got all different type of friends. I got my college friend. I got my racing friend. I race car too.
Okay.
Church buddies. The people that are in the band. I got all type of friends. So that's why I got knowledge.
What church you go to where the niggas in? I ain't never seen no niggas in church.
Like this?
No.
I go to My Name Missionary Baptist Church.
Oh, no.
And I also go to Turning Point.
Oh.
Church is the same.
My God. We love that.
I do it all.
I was in church on Sunday. I ain't see no niggas.
What?
No, not above driving age. I'm a jack
all trade. You never know. I'm with the sky.
Oh, child. I'm trying to see them niggas. I might want me a choir director.
They out here now.
I know it.
They out here. Yeah. That 9 out of 10 choir director going to have more woman already.
Oh, well.
You know what I'm saying?
I hear you. Come on now. Okay. We're going to get back. The question is how social media played a role with Gen Z?
Man, social media, like I said, you don't know who behind this screen, so you just think you talking to such and such, but such and such come out not such and such. So I think social media is easier to connect with somebody, but not somebody that you really need to be looking for at the same time. You will run across somebody that you need in person.
I see what you're saying. Social media, in so many ways, has been the detriment as well as the highlight of love.
Yeah.
With it can go either way.
It can start with a DM.
Yeah. It could, yeah. Or a message up under the pictures or whatever.
Yeah, that's how it can start.
Because some of them niggas bold.
Come on now. All
right.
Hey, they tripped me out with I know you on Facebook?
No.
You know, okay. On Facebook, just say, man, you post pictures yourself. Nigga, you ain't never heard of. He like, he about 90 years old.
Mm-hmm.
He gonna come in on your pitch.
You know what?
You look so sexy today.
Thank you. Thank you, Big Daddy.
How y'all feel? How y'all feel about them type of comments? How y'all women feel about them?
Me, I'm different. I'm confident. So shit like that don't bother me.
They can trip me out.
I be liking it. Well, okay, I lied. So I have a Facebook, but it is so old. It is so old. So when I was a Black Panther, the Africans and the Middle Easterns, they love the queens. They love the female Black Panthers.
All right.
So when they started posting me on the Black Panther Party Facebook page, them Africans came out of nowhere. And that's them up under every single one of my people. You are so beautiful. You're my beautiful queen.
Uh-oh.
I love you. You're so sexy.
They need to come here.
No, they don't.
They don't?
They take pussy off you. They don't ask for it. They'll take it up off you.
They have you.
You got to read the room. I think that would be the bottom line. Reading the room. And a lot of you niggas don't. Like, just too aggressive. They, I hate to use it, rapey.
Yeah.
It screams, you are going to take this cat. If I don't hand it to you, you might grab her from me. You know?
Yeah, niggas.
Yikes. Yikes. I'm basically teaching y'all how to try to holler at me in the DM.
They wait though.
That ain't my way though.
You right.
I know
they better adapt. They go back to adapt.
No, they better stay where they at and keep the bitches that they got. They know how to deal with them. I don't. That's why I'm trying to talk to the niggas.
Crazy. Like, we grow up on different type of levels. They grow up like, I didn't say grow up.
They did grow up that way. They were taught to be the head of the household, that everything that belongs to them is their property. I've dated African men before. Okay, my ex-boyfriend was Nigerian. His name was Richard. And I missed it niggas. I missed it niggas a lot because black men have a certain je ne sais quoi that a lot of African men do not have. Mm. But he looked at me as property, and it's not to be like belittling, but because I'm a descendant of slaves, anybody that looks at me as property is
cutthroat.
That's a red flag. So that is something that they take pride in their culture, but it's something that we don't have no reference with. It was difficult. He was great. He gave me whatever I wanted, showered me with love, affection, money, whatever I could want. But I was still, I missed the grit, the swag, the debonair of black men.
Uh-oh, Debbie.
Because that's what I grew up with.
See what I'm saying? I always go back to what you grew up with.
But you also...
It's crazy.
I also was in the position of constantly educating that nigga about black politics because he wasn't black. Who is the more predatorial gender in dating within and throughout the intersection and diaspora as a black person?
What we've been talking about all day, these niggas.
It's
the niggas. Okay. How can we do this? It's the niggas, but we gonna blame the females too.
Who is we? But
gonna blame the females too. The female, they'll lead you on knowing they already got something going on, but they lying the whole time too.
Not all of them.
Not all. That's what I said. We gotta say some.
Cause some, I know some bitches that ain't gonna never tell. They ain't even gonna lie. They just won't bring it up. I know some bitches that'll tell. Yeah, I know some bitches that'll tell you straight up. I got a nigga, but.
Right. Them new. So, maybe you not. Think that's a problem? A woman doing it?
Do you feel like you are capable of loving more than one person at one time?
Yeah.
I do too. So if me and my partner have an understanding that I don't like the idea of like open. I feel like that is also Eurocentric, but I have the capacity to be able to love multiple people. If you and your partner had that conversation and y'all have that agreement, then it shouldn't really be a problem. Cool. Now, I say this, Chris, and I said this two episodes ago. I admire LGBTQIA black male relationships because they are so far outside of the patriarchy. They're so far outside of like how relationships are supposed to work that they have the ability and capacity to be able to build their own relationships the way that they want to. Mm-hmm. They have the freedom to be able to invite a third person into their marriage, their relationship, into the bedroom. They have the ability to be able to go back and forth between men and women, but they are able to communicate with one another about what it is that works for their relationships and plan out in the future to see if it works or not. And if it doesn't work, nine times out of ten, they're able to go back to the drawing board and recruit.
And you said what type of people these are?
These black gay men.
Say it again.
Black gay men.
Two of them?
Yep.
See, that let you know right there, men ain't the problem then. If two men can get together and make some stuff happen, but a man give it a woman, it's gonna be the woman the problem. Then that's okay. Chris, come on, man. Talk to me. But
example.
I would never go that way. But
there's just one example.
It's on multiple people.
It is on multiple.
You see
people.
How many male and female relationships don't work because he probably because
he niggas deep down gay. Inside. That's what you're trying to say.
Uh oh. You said.
But I mean,
a lot of
black men have homoerotic relationships with their friends and peers. Like black men would prefer to spend time with niggas. They
why?
But I don't.
Okay, come from where I work at. Okay, a lot of black men, they still be at work when it's outside the clock. I can't. Why am I still at this job? You don't want to go home to your wife or your girl. Why you don't nagging? So you hit the door. It's a complaint.
But I feel like everybody, these bitches really ain't out. Everybody ain't nagging. I feel like nagging is a trait.
I feel like it is.
I don't think
if
so.
If you talking about niggas.
I don't feel like niggas don't know what nagging really is. I feel like nagging is a trait for an older woman.
Mm-hmm.
Older women nag because they going through their memory. They going through shit. young women ain't nagging.
What word you use?
I feel like women just be trying to talk and correct and redirect behavior before it becomes a problem, and men just don't want to hear it.
They call the problem George of the team. That's the woman.
No, I don't see that.
10, I'm chilling. Boom. You would just say, okay, this girl walked by. I look at her butt. Why are you looking at that? Now you finna just jump on me. Yeah. Now I'm mad now. Yeah. Now I got an attitude.
Now you got an attitude. But then with your eyes.
I just look. I'm sorry.
I feel, but there's a responsibility within y'all relationship. Yeah, there's not no excuse either. It's not, because I feel like a lot of black men lack self-control. Mm. You have to have the ability to be able to control yourself.
You got some clap.
Thank you. Thank you. I deserve that. Because that is one of the biggest turnoffs for me when it comes to black men.
Self-control.
Yes, because I come a real thick-ass bitch. So when you come and niggas see me, they won't put their whole hands on my body. They just can't help themselves. And I get that. If I was in your position, I feel the same way, too.
Hello.
But you got to be able to control yourself. When it comes to money, niggas will spend all their money on female. No, they spend their money on their niggas. You go to the club, they buying bottles. Niggas buying courtside tickets. They taking trips with they niggas.
Niggas gay.
I know that. They don't.
Niggas gay for real.
They really don't like women. And that's what women have been trying to say. Because it's not all black men. But I feel like it is the romanticization of the patriarchy. Because it is so great to be a man. The only thing that, only person that can truly understand it is another man.
There you go.
Then,
That's why niggas be with they niggas majority, but like, it just depends. Female, they just, and they mad about it.
I would be mad too.
I don't do it. I'm sorry. I'm at home all the time.
Yeah.
So I really can't speak upon the nigga that do it, because me personally, my girl won't do it. I'm with my girl. I'm not finna leave the house for y'all. I'm sorry, niggas. I already had my time with y'all. 13 years ago.
You the only one that feel that way. These niggas would be empty.
That's why they in the position they in now. And I'm in the position I'm in.
But I also feel like black men ain't really having those real, true-ass conversation with their niggas either. Like, why would you let a nigga spend all their time around
you? You got a girl.
But won't say nothing, won't send that nigga home, won't check on that nigga or his mental state. It's unfortunate. And that goes back to something I was talking about earlier about how black men don't really have no friends. Men will get together and talk about the most mundane things, the most nothing-ass things. We'll talk about relationships that have no substance whatsoever when there actually are real problems going on in the world.
Then say, when they talk about it, are you living it for real? That's all that's what I like.
Or are you listening for real?
Like, don't tell me, oh man, I need to do that. Do it. I got the same friends from high school. Right now, I've been friends with 10 plus years. All is in relationship. Hey, when you got some going, hey, that's your bit. Don't tell me. And like say, they understand about like the linking up all the time. Oh man, they don't even call me no more. They know I ain't going. I got to go with what I'm trying to build an empire over here. Mm-hmm. So I can't be with you all the time. But every time we link up, We good.
But niggas, that ain't no good. Because like that's not a real relationship. A lot of men are out of sight, out of mind, for real. So, let's say you were to move cross country. Maybe you was finna move to Alaska. How many of your niggas down here in Canton, Mississippi, do you really think gonna fly up to Alaska to check on your nigga ass?
My people I got,
They solid.
They solid. I got some real niggas. Everybody don't have
that privilege. Right. So I know you see what I'm saying.
I see what you're saying, yeah.
A lot of black men be feeling alienated. And mm-hmm. so that is why they go on social media.
That's why they stay in their same city too.
Yes. And
for so long in the same spot.
And they also listening to the same rhetoric that their daddy and their uncle have been speaking for the last few years.
Oh, Uncle Tom.
Yes, and that's what I'm saying. Like, you have to renew your mind. You have to start over. You have to be listening to different shit.
That's crazy. You talking about me?
I'm talking about you, Chris.
Everything that I was taught, I'm trying to delete that out of my head and come up with a common sense way of how to do it. So when people talk to me, I just look at them. Like, especially when I know you know what's going on in the world and you still doing, like, stupid stuff. I'm just going to stare at you because it's crazy. You stupid. You put yourself in a position. I'm big on you. You make your own bed, belly.
My God.
You dealing with this toxic girl, the toxic, you know this, what that person doing, and you still want to deal with it.
You lay down with dogs, you wake up with fleas.
Come on now, it's just that simple. So I don't know where they be coming from with all that. I didn't know. You know. You know what type of man that was. You know what type of woman that was before you got with that person. I'm choose wisely. Mm. Before we going to be together a year. We talking, dating for a year or at least. I need to see you on all sides. Good, bad, broke, rich, up, whatever you got going on. I need to see you all the way around.
And they don't do that.
They don't do that.
And
no
that's
more.
The thing too. A lot of black men kind of end up settling.
That's the word.
I personally feel like a lot of the guys that I have dated ended up loving me, but they were scared, so they left because they didn't feel like they had the ability to live up to my standards. Mm-hmm. And now they dating someone that they settled for.
Yeah,
I know that.
I bet it feels so bad. I know.
That's all I'm be sitting up there stalking everything I do on social media because I'm the one who got away. And again, I don't blame them.
I ain't the one that double tapped the picture that you posted a year ago then by accident.
Nigga won't DM me and tell me he missed me though.
Oh.
Whole thing.
They crazy. I think people be looking like, damn,
I know a lot of people do. I know that. I feel the same way about myself.
I'm a real.
Me too.
He hang around his homeboy so much because he ain't got no dad. But he ain't smart enough to know that. So as the woman in his life who's like, you can help this man elevate even if y'all don't stay together, go ahead and let him know, like, hey, listen, you cling on to your homie so hard because you ain't got no daddy. Just get it out the way. And it's going to provoke a thought. He's going to be like, damn, wait a minute. Next thing you know, he's looking around trying to figure out if his friends is his friends. But it needed to happen. That was a canon event for him. Like, just go ahead, tell him. Y'all need to stop being shit. Don't sugarcoat it. Don't be afraid to lose him. It is what it is. He need to grow up. He need to figure some shit out.
What narratives need to be changed and are released in order for heterosexual relationships to have harmony?
Okay. My narrative would be a female should choose a male. That would my narrative be. By a female, you know what I said earlier?
That bitches be out here choosing.
There you go. When a female chooses this specific guy and he is attracted to you, this is like 100% green. That's a green flag. Red flag, I'm a male liking a female and she got say choices. Mm-hmm. She already got choices, nigga. You ain't got no choice. You trying to.
But you can always work yourself up to the top.
You gotta start somewhere.
I know it.
But if you can't, everybody keep down and you ain't gonna never have nothing.
I feel like that's that bad bitch energy, that sassy energy that everybody keep on talking about, men waiting to be chose.
And it gotta be like that now. Okay. Who you think the prize, the woman or the man? Who is the pride nowadays?
Now, okay, society would tell us that, historically society would tell us that women are the prize.
How?
Because women are the curators of life. Women are the ones who have the womb to be able to create children. Women need to be protected. Women are the neck in which the head swivels. Mm-hmm. Women are the ones who are within the home sphere, but they're the ones recharging and regenerating the man and giving him the ideas to be able to perform.
Song.
Yes. Okay. If you are in a relationship worthwhile.
Okay. But okay, the man, he gotta pay the bills. He got to do all the outside activities that need to be done. Got to make sure everything's straight in the house at all costs. He got to be a protector, provider. So you don't think that the man is should be the prize as well?
Now, we was talking about society. We not talking about my personal thoughts.
Not you personal. I'm just saying, do you think men or women should be?
I'm not.
I just think a man.
Now, if you is my man, you okay. Is my king.
Right.
I would treat my man like how I would treat me, and I treat myself with the utmost respect and love.
I'm about this.
I take care of my nigga. Now, because I don't mind spoiling my nigga. And then on top of that, when my nigga come to my hometown and he around my family, he getting spoiled by my family. So, yes, in so many ways, the black man can be the prize. He is worthy. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I personally feel like as the woman, if we're going to be so biblically accurate, I should be put on a pedestal. I've always wanted to be the trophy wife in a situation. Why not? Like, save the charm for the girl on your arm. I'm the one that's gonna make you look better anyway. When you walk in the room, niggas gonna be wondering where you got me from. Uh-oh. Any fucking way. Okay, well, how did he get with her? Well, she too fine for him.
What Aunt gonna say? What is Aunt saying? Got you one, ain't nephew? Okay. Or something like that. I forgot how to say it.
So that's how I feel. Men are definitely valuable. They bring so much to the relationship. And personally, I don't want to be in a relationship where a man cannot provide me with man security. Man,
so be a leader or all this.
I mean, so but they don't.
A leader not be the prize?
I don't know, because I am the leader.
Right. So both of y'all can lead. Help. I feel like ain't no he or she ain't no pride.
Ain't no such thing as
there you go.
We both the pride.
There you go. We both it is. So you got to do some roles. I got to do some roles.
So all this for the last 8 months, niggas been arguing about the same conversations, mm-hmm. and now we done solved all the world's problems.
Everybody, we are hermit. At the end of the day, you a hermit. I'm a hermit.
I'm a hermit. You a hermit.
You a woman, I'm a man.
Yup.
So we still, you got to go to work to pay bills? I got to go work to pay bills.
Okay, well, so I'm selling pussy or selling pies.
We can do the same exact thing. I feel like men and women equal.
Equal.
I know what I feel.
Now, the Bible say that.
We ain't, though, but.
Yeah, you know, y'all.
But nowadays, we got to go back to nowadays. It's hard out here, man. It take two. Like I said, that mortgage, they rent $2,000. God, I think I pay my car on my insurance. That's another $500-$600. And your stuff, too. That's another five. That's double everything.
Babe, that's double everything.
We need two. Mm. Possibly three.
It take two to tango. Nah, well, you ready to go to jail over three? Polygamy, polyamory.
I want mine.
And you want yours.
But you know, that's all nigga, though. But,
Let me tell you something about these men in the world. Men are the highest in the nursing homes. Mm. Let me tell you why. That the moms and the grandmoms and the aunties and the sisters are all being taken care of out here in these streets, and they got people to nourish them and make sure they straight when they get old. And the men is the only ones in the nursing homes is because they deadbeats. They don't take care of their children. They cheat on a woman. They cheat on their wives with men. They don't help their family members. As soon as they get money, they get their girlfriend. They take care of their girlfriend. They don't take care of their mom. Their mom house falling apart. Roofs is filled with water and black mold. And they want to be outside flying these streets taking drugs. And guess what? In the end, after they done cheated on everybody, done been disloyal to their children, but want to be they loyal to their homeboy. If you're not loyal to your children, you're not loyal. Mm-hmm. Y'all do anything for y'all homeboy, but when y'all get locked up, y'all want to call y'all baby moms and y'all women. But after all that you done did, you're going to get old, and guess what? Your dick going to stop working. And you're going to need Viagra. And guess what? You're going to be sitting in a nursing home. And you have a nurse taking care of you. And won't nobody call you. Just like when you get locked up in jail, don't nobody call your ass. Mm-hmm. And they don't answer no motherfucking phone calls. And they don't put no money on your commissary. Because bitches is tired of y'all. And y'all kids can't stand y'all.
Wow.
So what is another narrative that needs to be changed or released within our community?
Narrative need to be changed. In relationship.
Mm-hmm. That 50-50 shit is something that don't need to be changed for real.
50-50 trip me out every time I hear it. It just trips me out. Because, like I said, we hermit. We got to work together to... We black. Already. So, you already know it's a... We different. We going to have to work extra harder to get a job. When we get the job, we're going to have to work extra harder to maintain that job. Especially work for the white man. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they getting all your damn taxes. But we ain't going to talk about taxes right
now. Nah, we ain't going to talk about taxes right now.
But it's hard. So we got to stop.
Another narrative is like for women, the responsibility of child rearing belongs to women solely. I think that's another narrative that needs to be changed.
What do you think if men had to carry the babies? Would it be a lot of babies out here?
No, I know that
they get rid of.
Yeah. So have you seen the experiment of like police officers getting tased and stuff, or doing like the cramp experiments and stuff? So number one, tattoo artists always say that when they're doing tattoos, women take the pain way better than men do. Right. Number two, like
you got tattoo?
No, I got piercings. Hey, you lit, dog.
Not yet. I ain't got none.
So then when you see people doing the cramp test, men think they so strong and macho, but they get
that. I can't take it by hearing it.
It's hurting, and you can't be able. So if you were really, for number one, when you are pregnant, you are quite literally putting your body on the line from the moment that you find out you're pregnant to the moment that you give birth. So, like, no, I don't think men are selfless enough to be able to go through the gestational process of carrying a baby. Mm-hmm. I don't think that men are physically or mentally capable of being able to see their body changing as quickly and to be able to care for babies that way. Mm-hmm. No, I don't think that men are have been fostered or prepared to be able to just deal with that type of labor. That does not include the transition from being a non-parent to a parent overnight and mm-hmm. then dealing with that child. No. Just imagine you sitting up there, you just gave birth and the baby start crying and your nipples leaking.
Niggas, I don't know what to do.
Nah, you gonna have to put on a wife beat up under your shirt.
I don't know what. What the baby gonna come out of?
Your booty hole. Well, you know, Zeus, the Greek god, he carried two babies. So Zeus carried Athena in his skull, and she cracked his skull open and came out. And then Zeus carried Dionysus in his thigh. His wife died when she was pregnant with Dionysus, so he ripped his thigh open, put it in there, and sewed it up, and carried him to gestation as well.
Oh my god, I ain't know nothing about that.
Yeah, that's Greek mythology. That's white people shit.
Okay. In his skull, though?
Yeah. And yeah, Athena cracked his skull open and came out.
So he dead, right?
No, he a god. He don't die. So he lived through that.
Dang, that sounds very fictional.
Yeah, it's full. But that's in the white person's imagination. That ain't got nothing to do with me.
But we talking about narrative. They changed the whole, I feel like they changed the whole narrative about what's really going on in the world from start to finish. I'm starting with Christopher Columbus. They've been alive ever since then.
Yes, he didn't discover America. Someone with the last name America discovered America.
That's right.
Yeah, because this would probably be the United States of Columbus. But, you know, who am I?
Hey, you know about it. You went to school for it. You know, my little thought. I just feel like they changed the narrative everywhere. Like the Bible. I just feel like the Bible got some stuff in there that they done put in. The 10%. I got to give my money. It's money now. But back then it was trades.
Coins. And,
now I got to give you $10,000.
10,000 goats. Hey, I ain't got it. I know.
Hello, you said it again.
You got your shout outs.
The other side of hopeless romantic, gentlemen, is stalker. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. You took a cookie from a crazy woman. She will never let you give that cookie back. And it goes like this. You took her out. Y'all went to eat. You dropped her off. You're on your way home. First date. Your phone is ringing, right? So that's your queen. I just dropped her off. Listen, I know I'm going to sound crazy. But I'm very spiritual. When I was looking at you eat your pizza tonight, my ancestor spoke to me and said, he is definitely the one. No matter what, don't ever let him walk away. And so she starts stalking you, showing up at your job, showing up at your house, threatening suicide if she can't see you, slicing herself up, calling the cops, stalking you on your social media. Brother, you should have never took a cookie from a crazy woman. She will bust your car windows, beat your mother up, smack your baby mom. She'll come to church and tell the pastor to sit his ass down. Stay away from crazy women. But you know why we can't stay away from crazy women? Do y'all want to know the truth why black men cannot leave crazy ass women alone? Because they got the best cookies! And every sister who got a brother know what I'm talking about. Because you told your brother she's going to get you locked up. You're going to lose everything you got. You didn't work too hard. And she came by with them heels and them jeans with that crazy ass one eyeball. And you can always tell the crazy sisters. Because they be having battle scars. Tattoos that say rest in peace 5 times. And then you got, that's hopeless romantic, homicidal honey. That's the woman who will slice you up and take your life, brothers. These are women who've been in domestically abusive relationships. Soon when you raise your voice, she go into a trauma memory and she pulling out the shoddy on you. Stay away from traumatized women, women who always want to fight you, they want to smack you, they want to kick you. Some women have been so abused, black man, the only way you can show her you love her is to hurt her. Some women are like that. Get away from them. The worst woman you can date is a woman who needs you to hurt her to be convinced you care about her. You ever date a woman who says, why you never hit me? What the fuck? What kind of question is that? How do I know you really love me? Oh, hell no. I got to get up out of here. And then you got Miss Hot in the Pants. It got quiet in here. This the woman. Her cookies ain't even done yet. She giving them out anyway. Butter almond. Butter pecan. Rum raisin. Brothers, if you run into a sister who trying to give you cookies too soon, I need you to be a strong spiritual brother. I need you to say, sister, I'm a righteous black man. I will not take them cookies. Put your clothes on, go home, and we're going to go to Bible study tomorrow. And right before she get the door, wait a minute. Would you like some pineapple upside down cake? So you're hopeless romantic, you're homicidal honey, you're hot in the pants, your home wrecker and your healer. But I'm going to tell you like this. The other side.
Shout out to the slaves.
Yeah, shout out to the slaves. You feel me? Shout out to Harriet Tubman.
She's a real nigga.
Shout out to them Mississippi niggas. Yeah, shout out to them Mississippi niggas. Yeah, big penitentiary tractor dragging ass niggas. Yeah. And they don't talk loud. They whisper. Dangerous niggas whisper.
And shout out again to all those people who hate my guts.
Y'all are doing a justice and an effort to the world. Keep breaking these men down one at a time.
Shout out LGBTQ.
You are obsessed and sick.
And we are back with the Big Black Shout Out, the blackest shout out in the world. For those who do not know, the Big Black Shout Out is a segment that is all about circulating the black dollar back into our communities, as well as showcasing hidden black owned gems. So, Chris, who would you like to shout out today?
First of all, I'd like to shout out to God. That's number one right now.
Real nigga.
Real one. Because God is black. Hello. But anyway. Like okay, so I'm going to shout out my mom and my daddy. First, you know, they might come back. What you say about me? Okay. And we got a company, High Fashion. She is owned by my classmate, Jabran Archer.
What it is?
It's in Canton. All this in Canton. I'm going to talk about.
Come on.
Canton, Exit 119, Canton, Mississippi. Y'all got to be there. We got Blockstar. He got, like, Search, Tyree Smith. QBG. Shout out to QBG, man. Shout out to QBG. The whole QBG. Everybody. All the rappers. Everybody that live back there. Everybody. I got to shout out to them.
Yo.
Who else we got?
Oh. Shout out to them Mississippi niggas.
We got them Mississippi niggas. Wow. We got Wave Master. Shout out to Wave Master. They say it now. Them guys. They at the North Park Mall. If you ever go to North Park, Ridge, you can check them out.
What the Wave Master do? They do hair.
Oh, no. They don't even do hair.
God damn it.
They sell clothes. My, this is a clothing brand. My bad, y'all. Y'all popped up. We come out some brushes or something.
Some waves.
They got some, hey, you got to see their clothes. They got some fiber jars to see you a look. They got one, two.
One, two.
They good. Okay, we got High Levels Kitchen. Zay. this. You want some wings? Quesadillas, salad, Alfredo.
Niggas making quesadillas.
We ain't playing it, can't I see? We ain't playing.
I gotta go down there and get me one of them.
Then we got chill way too.
Okay.
Got Marlo. We got everything. I told you I'm pro. Ain't no but black. Everybody. I just got to shout out the whole Canton, Mississippi. You got something going on down there. You listen to this. Shout out to you, man. Don't be mad at me because I ain't shout you out. We East Side, turn up the East Side. We got to shout out the East Side. That's why I was saying. This is Northwest. Northwest, shout out to y'all. West Side over there in the park. You already know about y'all, too.
Keep it going.
I'm trying to get everybody. You know, that's
because
I put everybody to keep.
That's love.
I was the class favorite of my class.
What class you graduated?
2016.
All right.
They love me.
Shout out to class 2016.
Shout out to when you graduated?
2015.
Oh, you right. I read it for people
too. Y'all, hey, bro.
My bad, but we're going to talk about
what you flunked on your birthday late?
Birthday late.
All right.
When your birthday?
Early April 9th.
Yes, I'm right after you. You born that time?
Yeah.
I ain't that crazy. I had a cousin that graduated 2015 birthday like a few days before mine.
And they put you in the class?
Yes.
They hate you.
Sick of these folks. But soon I turned 16, got me a job. Okay. Hello for everybody.
Shout out to that 16.
Somebody shout out to Ken. What we got? Malik. We got Malik Heat on the Green Bay Packers from Ken, Mississippi, Weatherspoon, Quint Deer, all the Weatherspoon, Deeper, all the boys. Everybody got some going on. They play basketball.
Oh, shout out to the Hoopers.
Weatherspoon. Play basketball.
The only exercise I do is running my mouth.
Oh, you gotta get out there. That
wow, deal. I ain't running these checks up too.
Kendall Pierce. Shout out to that boy.
Uh-huh.
He a great guy.
That's a wow.
That's a great guy.
Wow.
I gotta show you him.
That's powerful.
He a Marine.
He a Marine?
Come on now.
That nigga scary.
Every time I see him, he at top of class.
Yeah, he big as fuck, ain't he?
He smiles.
Oh my God.
He's smart.
Smart. You got to be extremely smart to become a Marine.
Yeah. Every time I see the top of clay now.
Oh, wow.
He graduated from
home. Hey, man, shout out to those black military vets, active service.
Spodak, shout out to you, boy.
Hey, bro, all my love belongs to y'all.
Bro squad.
Y'all are the real protectors of this country, serving a country that don't even serve y'all.
Hell, ain't that crazy?
I love
There's so many homeless veterans. What's going on?
They don't give a fuck about them, but the Afrocentric podcast does.
We care about y'all.
Wait, bro. Y'all the realest ones.
And now, shout out to Mayberry TV. Y'all go follow your boy.
So, if you have a black podcast or anybody you know has a black podcast and you believe they deserve a shout out, make sure you are emailing me. That's AfrocentricPodcast@gmail.com.
G'day, g'day, g'day. Don't skip. Let me interrupt the podcast that you're currently listening to with some blatant self-promotion. What do you get when you mix two Aussie mates, a splash of booze, well, more than a splash, and some microphones? You get Cheers Big Ears, hosted by myself, the Chad, and my mate, Matt, and sometimes, but more often than not now, my missus, Bobby. It's a podcast of adult beverages and not-so-adult conversation. It's not serious. Far from it. Well, except for that one episode, but that was just that one. We're available wherever you get your podcast fix. Cheers, Big Ears.
Chris, I have really enjoyed recording this episode with you. There is Piss in the Segregated Dating Pool. I want to thank you so much for coming all this way to record with me. Before I let you go, is there anything that you would like to say to the black community?
I would love to tell these people, okay, stay down till you come up. That's it. Take that in a relationship. Take that at work. You take that, you try to save some money. You take that information anywhere. Stay down till you come up. Don't rush the process.
That's poetic, Chris. I like that. Hey, I want to thank you for being Afrocentric today. I want to thank my listeners as well. Thank you guys so much for choosing to be Afrocentric today. I want to remind you guys that Black Lives Matter. Make sure that you listen and protect Black women. And the only thing that you must do in this lifetime is be Black and die. And here at the Afrocentric Podcast, we're just civilized people having civilized conversations. I'll talk to you guys soon. Bye-bye. Addicted to dick, she got ADD. I ain't never ever picked a bitch that ain't picked me.
good pussy will not heal his trauma. It will not fix his credit score. It will not morph him into the man you've conjured in your imagination. You can't teach a grown man how to unlearn his father's mistakes if his heart is unwilling and immature. You can't prop open his mouth and force the language of commitment down his throat. I don't care about what your mouth can do if your tongue is swollen with pride. How come every time I let you inside of me, it feels like a home invasion? I've tried to sanitize your lies before consumption, but I refuse to digest the promises of a trespasser. See, you don't reciprocate. You just take all the good and mercy out of me. See, I just want the girlies to protect their peace and pH balance. Some of these men aren't worth the inconvenience, not worth the perpetuating cycle of you compromising yourself. The geography of your body is sacred land. It is not a cemetery for him to bury the corpse of his guilt and shame inside of you. Can't have your pussy power popping on someone who doesn't value the honey molasses in your womb, the magical sugar cane you possess. Listen, you do whatever you want to do with your body as you should, because it is your prerogative and only you can define your non-negotiables. But when I see another woman, I see my sister. And for that reason, I choose to love her. Fix her crown without insulting her. Remind her that she is the daughter of mourning. No matter what transpired the night before, she will always rise. I also see a curious woman, exploring the facets of her body, the full moon in her hips, the glory in her thighs. Place your pussy power on a pedestal. Let these men know that you are not easily accessible. And when he tries to slither his way back into the crevices of your safe haven, you tell him that your body is not a rehabilitation center. Tell him to go seek wise counseling and therapy. He will not find redemption on your lips tonight. You tell him to be brave. Step out into the deep end. Learn how to swim in the ocean of his insecurities. You can't be his life jacket this time around, and your heart can't endure any more water damage. You hold him accountable for vandalizing your body, the only place you can call home.